Gazing into the night sky, the stars appear to be the very definition of eternal, and if not uniform, they seem, to the naked eye at least, to appear fairly similar. What's really going on, however, is much less orderly, and in some cases, downright weird. Joining us now to explain, Emily Levesque. She is an assistant professor of astronomy at the University of Washington in Seattle, and she joins us tonight thanks to her visit to our neck of the woods for a lecture at the Perimeter Institute for Theoretical Physics in Waterloo, Ontario, and it's great to meet you, have you here.
Great to be here.
What makes a star weird?
So I consider a star weird if it's doing something that we can't explain. There are stars that can behave very strangely. They will fling off lots of mass or suddenly disappear without warning. And what I like about these is that they really stretch our understanding of how stars work. So if we can study sort of the weird stars, the oddballs, and find the physics that can explain how they're behaving, it gives us a better understanding of the physics of stars as a whole.
Weird is not the most scientifically specific adjective I've ever heard used, however. Do you feel any awkwardness using that kind of word?
I don't at all, because if I were to try and scientifically list off every possible thing that made a star weird, we'd be here forever. And weird actually makes for a very good umbrella covering everything that we see.
Ain't it the truth? Okay, let's bring our first image up here. We're going to show several images, and you discovered a weird star. What are we looking at here?
So this is an artist's illustration of something called a Thorne-Zhitkov object. So to understand what makes a star weird, it always helps to know what makes a star normal. So a normal star, something like our sun or anything that you see in the night sky, is fusing hydrogen or helium in its core. It does this to sort of maintain a balancing act between the inward press of gravity and the outward push of that fusion. And that's how a star is able to sort of be supported and survive. What these stars are is objects predicted by Kip Thorne and Anna Zhitkov back in the mid-1970s. It's how they got their name. And these stars do not have normal cores like that. No hydrogen or helium fusion. They have cores actually supported by principles of quantum physics. But from the outside, they look very much like normal stars. So we went on a hunt for these a few years ago, looking for very subtle, very interesting chemical signatures that might tell us that these stars have these strange cores. And to our great surprise, we found one.
You went on the hunt for it?
Yes.
How?
We went down to a telescope in Chile and assembled a list of stars that we thought might look like Thorne-Zhitkov objects. Most of them turned out to be normal, but they gave us a sort of nice baseline for saying, well, these are normal stars, and then for comparison, we found this one that's very strange.
Did you have some sense before you looked into the telescope where in the night sky you would find this?
We had planned exactly where we were going to look. We were looking in a very small galaxy right near our own Milky Way called the Small Magellanic Cloud. And we had a list of all the stars, so we just went through them one by one, took the data digitally, and then analyzed the data later and realized what we found.
Yeah, Sheldon, can we put that one more time up, that last one? Okay, which is the big circle on the left, mm-hmm. or the saucer-shaped thing on the right? Which is actually the weird star?
So this is actually an illustration of how these weird stars form, and one day those two stars are going to merge. What we have is a normal star on the left, and then this tiny quantum physics supported star, something called a neutron star, on the right. Once the two merge, this will have formed what we call a Thorne-Zhitkov object.
And how long will it take before that happens?
It's hard to say. This is the first one we've ever found, so we still have a lot of questions about how long it takes them to form, how long they live, what it'll look like when they die. It's all still very unclear.
This is the first one that you have found, but is this the first one that has ever been found?
We think this is the first one that has ever been found. These stars were predicted for 30, 40 years, and this looks to be the first one.
Do you get to name it, therefore?
No, it already has a very uncatchy name. It's called HV2112. It was already in a catalog, but nobody had ever looked at it this closely. Nobody had ever realized it was this strange.
Who would go with that when you could call it, the Levesque superstar or something like that?
Maybe next time.
Okay. How do you take the temperature of that?
We will actually take the temperature of a star like that by looking at a couple things. We'll look at its color, and we'll also sort out the light that we get from the star into something called a spectrum, where you sort out light by individual colors and look for basically fingerprints of atoms or molecules present in the outer layers of the star. Based on which atoms and molecules are around, you can estimate how hot the surface of the star must be.
And do you have a ballpark guess on what you think it is?
That star is about 3,100 degrees Celsius.
That's warm.
Yep. Yeah. But, you know, terribly cold as compared to most stars. Our sun is about 5,500 degrees Celsius.
Huh. Yeah. Almost twice as much.
Yep.
Interesting. Okay. Now, that was an artist's rendition. Mm-hmm. This next picture that we're going to show is the real deal. Again, a weird star. What are we looking at here?
So this is a star called Eta Carina, and it is an incredibly weird star. It's actually a star in our own Milky Way. It's only about 7,500 light years away. And if you look at the image, it looks like you're seeing a star that's exploded. So this star underwent an enormous eruption back in the year 1843. It actually became the second brightest star in the sky for a few nights. And incredibly, the star survived that eruption. There's actually two stars buried in there, in the inside of that whole mess that you see on the screen.
I was going to say, which part is the star and which part is the piece that has been projectiled out?
All of the material that you see in sort of those two balloons to either end, mm-hmm. and the stuff popping out of the middle is material that was ejected. And deep inside that, you can barely see it, are actually two different stars. And both of them are tens of times the mass of our own sun. They're orbiting one another, they're disrupting one another. We think they're actually so bright that they get unstable. So it's a very fascinating system, but one that we still have a lot of questions about.
And have you seen this?
I have observed this a little bit, yes. I think you'd be hard-pressed to find a telescope in the world that has not pointed at Eta Carina at some point.
Eta Carina. So if I'm looking up in the sky on a typical, you know, summer's night where there's no illumination from the city and you can really see all the stars out there, where am I looking to find that?
Well, I've got some bad news for anybody in Canada because it's actually in the Southern Hemisphere.
Ah, so we're not going to see it.
No, but if you went down to the Southern Hemisphere and found somewhere very dark, you actually would be able to look out and find the star with the naked eye.
Hmm. Really, with the naked eye? You don't need a telescope or anything?
You'll see a lot more with the telescope.
Yeah, sure. Yeah. When we are looking at that night sky and we are seeing all those stars, what are we actually looking at?
I always like people to think of looking up at the sky as being like looking back in time, because the light from all of those stars is coming towards us as fast as it possibly can at the speed of light, but these things are still 7,500 light years away in the case of Eta Carina, and in some cases, billions of light years away. So the light that we're getting here at Earth now was emitted many, many years ago. So by looking into the sky, we're seeing light from extremely far in the past. It means that observatories and astronomers can sometimes sort of act like time machines and look at very distant objects to learn about what things were like in the very early universe.
So the star we see, if I'm looking at the Big Dipper, for example, those stars are actually not there as we are looking at them.
Well, they might still be there. The problem is they may look a little bit different. That's light that those stars emitted many years ago.
Many meaning how many?
Oh, it depends on the distance to the star. So Eta Carina would be 7,500 years ago. Every single star is at its own distance, even though they all look like they're in the same place. So each one is giving us our own little time machine looking back to what that star looked like.
If that's the case, do we know if those stars, whose images we're seeing today, even exist anymore?
No, we don't. There are a couple stars that very well could have exploded, and we just don't know it yet because the light from the explosion hasn't made it to Earth.
They don't just burn out? They have to explode?
Some of them will burn out and some will explode. This is actually one of the key differences between stars like our sun and some of the very strange stars that I study, like Eta Carina.
Wow. This just gets more and more interesting by the second. No wonder you're into all this. Okay, let's bring up graphic number 3 now. The Crab Nebula. Wow, doesn't this look like right out of an episode of Star Trek? What are we looking at here?
So this is an example of what happens after a star has exploded. So if a star is very massive, about 8 times the mass of our sun or more, it will undergo the spectacular death as a supernova. So the Crab Nebula is the remnant of a supernova that actually happened in the year 1054. We have records of it from Chinese, from Arabic astronomers. There's actually a drawing on the wall of a cave dwelling in New Mexico that we think might depict that supernova.
Huh.
And what you're seeing in that image is what's left behind. This is all the material that got blasted out from the surface of the star after its core collapsed and then rebounded to give us this beautiful fireworks show that we see as a supernova.
And do you know what that material actually is?
Yes, we've observed it in a lot of detail. It's material from the outer layers of the star that's now been propelled out at incredible speed into the interstellar medium and is in the process of making what we refer to as, you know, star stuff. These sorts of explosions are one of the ways that we make the elements that we see in the universe.
Now, stars are, I guess for lack of a better expression, white or orange or yellow or something. I mean, to the naked eye, they appear that way. This is just the most magnificent collection of, you know, blues and greens and, I mean, why and how and et cetera.
What we're actually seeing in an image like that is a composite of observations taken from different telescopes. So I know that there's Hubble Space Telescope data in there, as well as data from other telescopes. And we will color code it for ease of observation so that our eyes can see it as something that we understand. Those lines and filaments and the gas in that image are definitely different colors, but they might be infrared or ultraviolet. And it's easiest for us to interpret an image like that when we color ultraviolet light blue, for example, or infrared light red. It makes it easier for us to see what's going on in an object like that.
I see. Okay. And you said this has its roots in the 11th century, but when do you think it exploded?
To know that, you would have to look up the exact distance to the Crab Nebula. And then once you had that, you would just say, oh, it's this many light years away, plus however long it's been since 1054, and we'd know to the day. It exploded on July, we saw it on July 4th, 1054.
Huh. Okay. Let's talk about our sun.
Yes.
93 million miles away? Is
yep.
that what it is?
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Is it a normal star?
Yes, I'm sorry to say our sun is quite disappointingly normal. And this isn't just because we think it's normal. It's not just normal because it happens to be the closest star to Earth. If you were to gather up all of the stars in the Milky Way and other nearby galaxies, you would have countless stars just like our sun, the same temperature, the same mass. Everything about it is quite normal. Really, the only thing that's strange is that we are here. It is the only star we know about that has a planet with life on it so far.
So it's not weird in any way?
It's not weird in any way, sadly.
Hydrogen, helium, based inside and all of that, like you told us before.
Yep.
And do you have any idea where we are in the sun's life cycle?
Yeah, so our sun is about 4.5 billion years old, which for star standards, that's very middle-aged. It's been fusing hydrogen in its core since it was born, and it will keep doing that for about another 5 billion years. So our sun is going to stick around for quite a while, doing what it's always been doing, fusing hydrogen, and the good news is, at least for the next 5 billion years, it should change very little.
In which case, at what point do Earthlings need to worry about their star burning out, which presumably would massively affect life on the planet as we know it?
Oh, yes. This really becomes a problem when the sun runs out of hydrogen to fuse. And we've got 5 billion years, so we've got some time. But once that happens, the core of the sun will start to shrink and heat up. It'll eventually get hot enough to start fusing helium, so it will have found another fuel source, and it'll be able to get about another billion years of life. But while that's happening, the outer layers of the sun start to puff up and cool off. And this is when the sun becomes what we call a red giant. So when that happens, the surface of the sun will extend out past the orbit of Venus, and Earth will be quite uninhabitable at that point.
Because it will be too...
The sun will have cooled off dramatically and will now be far too large and quite close to Earth's orbit.
Meaning we heat up, or it doesn't have any heat anymore?
I think the interactions with Earth and our atmosphere will cause problems before the sun even makes it all the way here.
And I don't know why I'm asking you so many questions about this, because we're not going to be around to worry about this, right?
You know, 5 billion years...
is a long time.
We've got time, yeah.
But something tells me somewhere in your back pocket you're working on a plan for immortality, so you never know. We might have to worry about this. Okay, so that's something that anybody watching us right now doesn't have to worry about, so we'll move on.
Yeah.
What can studying stars tell us?
So there's a couple different things. I mentioned before this quote that you hear attributed to Carl Sagan all the time of we're all made from star stuff. And stars really are factories for making most of the atoms that we see in the universe, whether it's in their interiors or when they explode as supernovae. So if we better understand stars, we have a better understanding of all of the chemistry around us, and we have a good understanding of the chemistry of the universe. Some of the stars that I study are also unbelievably bright when they die, when they make something like a supernova. And you can see some of these things from well across the universe. What that means, as I mentioned before, is that we're looking back in time and we're seeing the deaths of stars that were born in some of the earlier stages of the universe. So it really gives us a glimpse again into how our universe has formed.
Now here's another artist's rendering of a neutron star. Why don't we bring that one up, Sheldon? There we go. What are we looking at here?
So a neutron star is what's left behind after a star goes supernova. This is the remnant of the star's core, which has collapsed in on itself. I'd mentioned before this careful balancing act that stars have to maintain, where they fuse something in their cores to counteract the inward sort of press of gravity. This happens after a very massive star has failed. The core implodes, the outer layers of the star bounce off that core, and that's what we see as a supernova, and this is what gets left behind.
Does it emit any heat?
Yes, these stars shine, but they are actually supported not by fusion, but by principles of quantum physics. So a star like this will be maybe the size of the city of Toronto, but a teaspoon of it would weigh as much as a mountain. So they're very tiny, very dense, and this is all that's left of the enormous star that has previously exploded.
And presumably you need a massive telescope to find that. You can't see that with the naked eye.
No.
Right, okay. Next picture, Sheldon. This is graphic number 5, the proverbial black hole.
Yes.
What do you want to tell us about that?
So black holes are sort of the next extreme after something like a neutron star. We will see stars' cores collapse and form neutron stars, but sometimes that collapse goes even further and they collapse into a black hole. So this object that is infinitely small, infinitely dense, that we see in this example with a companion star that it's interacting with. You can see it drawing material off of that companion into something that we call an accretion disk around the black hole itself.
And can you go inside the black hole?
Things go into black holes all the time. We can tell you very little about what happens to them.
Is it called a black hole because there is an absence of anything in there? No energy, no life, no nothing?
The name black hole actually doesn't come from what's inside, but rather what's involved with getting out of a black hole. This is something where even moving at the speed of light, you would not be able to escape the object's gravity. So this is why we refer to them as black holes. Even light can't escape from one.
Gotcha. Okay, one more image we're going to take a look at here. You told us about the red giants before. This is a red supergiant, is that right?
Yes, so this is actually the constellation Orion, which is something a lot of people are familiar with. You can find it in the night sky if you look for those distinctive three stars that make the belt.
Three stars in the belt, right.
And the star on the upper left in the image is Betelgeuse. So Betelgeuse is a red supergiant. These are stars that are even more extreme than red giants, and in particular, they're much larger. So I'd mentioned before that when the sun becomes a red giant, it will reach out past the orbit of Venus. If you took one of the largest red supergiants that we know about and put it where the sun is, its surface would stretch past the orbit of Jupiter.
My goodness, massive.
Very huge.
Absolutely massive. And you can see that red supergiant in the night sky with the naked eye?
Yes, you can actually tell when you look at Betelgeuse that it's red. I think most of the time when people look at stars, they just sort of look bluish or whitish and sort of sparkly and pretty. And Betelgeuse is very obviously an orangey-red color, which I love that you can see with the naked eye.
Let me just ask you one last question, and that is, when you get up in the morning, do you realize how awesomely amazing your work is?
I really do. It's something that's hard to forget. We're very lucky to be studying some of the most fascinating things literally in the universe. I tend to think of astronomy as very much a gateway science, that it's something that captures everybody's imagination and curiosity. Whenever I sit next to somebody on a plane, they have that one question they've always wondered about astronomy. And this doesn't necessarily mean that everybody is going to go out and become an astronomer, that a little kid looking at one of these beautiful images is going to become an astronomer, but it may mean that they get curious about science and realize that math and science classes are how we do things like this, and it'll pull them into science in general.
Very cool. Emily Levesque, University of Washington, Astronomy Department. Really glad you could spend so much time with us on TVO tonight. Thank you.
Thank you.
The Agenda with Steve Paikin is brought to you by the Chartered Professional Accountants of Ontario. Helping businesses stay on the right side of change with strategic thinking, insightful decisions, and business leadership. Are you on the right side of change? Ask an Ontario CPA.